thank you so far for what we've done. This is, I am sorry. I talked to the council chair this week and said, you know, the spending for the building is a lot easier than this, because we're dealing, it's just, you know, in a lot of, it's not clear, but you're trying to basically put something together, you get your hands around, make a decision, and realizing that whatever we do, there's no guarantee. Variance is within anything that we do, there's no guarantee on the way the county does business or the way it might do business, but the question is whether we're doing it better. So what, since the last meeting, we had some additional questions after the meeting that we posed to Holly and the consultants. And I got a small working group, so we can go through this on our off day. And I think we're really the only people in the building, you and Larry Lutow, Ryan Frederick, and Steve Hunsine. And spent a couple hours going through the numbers and going through the models and saying what would be a reasonable recommendation so that we could present it to you today in terms of what our thought process is and get feedback and reach some conclusion. And that's sort of the four slides that were, they're not slides because I really want this to be a discussion. The first thing, our recommendation is we should do something. But I want to make sure that I'm comfortable that everyone here is comfortable. When we say do something, really, there is a need for a courthouse. That we've heard from Gelfman, we've heard from county officials, that there's a need for that we have to do this, the state's requiring it. But I want to make sure that we're in agreement as we move forward and then look at the models. And we indicate the key reasons we heard it. And I think, I don't know if Josh is here, but I had a discussion. Josh missed that two meetings ago. So I reached out to a number of people that weren't there and just chatted with them. And one of the things he said was, I made the comment, well, it's just a courthouse. You know, the state's requiring us to do it. Can we find ways to cut the hell out of it and just do it simple? Why are we doing something that's trying to be the best in class and better for the county than something that would, you know, that is not the county's decision to do? And he made a really good point to me, and it struck home, that the judicial system, the courthouse, it's just an incredibly important thing to our life and how we, what our democracy means and how we deal with differences, how we deal with whether they be criminal or civil. The courthouse, the district courthouse is a, or the circuit courthouse it would be, is important to our system. So it isn't, it may be pushed down by the state, but it's still very important to everything else that we do. I just quoted you, Josh, on the importance of a courthouse to our system of government. So our recommendations, we need to move forward on that, and those are the reasons. And before we go any further, I really want to just turn to you and just get a sense of the group. Is there anyone that has a negative? Is there any issues or concerns we shouldn't do this?
It's not a concern that we shouldn't do this. There's definitely a compelling reason to do this. The piece that I'm just a little not totally clear on is a price tag. Understanding the importance to build a courthouse and to build a beautiful courthouse and state-of-the-art at that. But we haven't gone into too much detail on the price, and if we're questioned about that, I just want to make sure that there's some sort of justification as to what we're spending on this.
I think that the estimates, where the consultants and Holly, the cost, the construction cost, and all, there was a separate consultant that they used, I think that was Arcadis.
Arcadis, yeah, the team of consultants, Arcadis was the lead. And then we just researched on our own based on what other courthouses cost, other studies that I saw done by the General Services Administration for the federal government that an actual cost of the courthouse after the fact. Jenny is probably one of the better numbers, and there are numerous estimates of courthouses that have been built or are about to be built. So it's going to get the mix of numbers right now.
The cost is about $227 million. I'm sorry. Oh, you mean on the oven?
Yeah.
And just let me clarify, so I said we got a variety of numbers. That was for the square foot cost of the courthouse. And we had separate estimates, and again, numbers for the church and the parking garage, and then arcade office numbers for site development, and also demolition and Dorsey building. So there's several components that kind of went into that overall $138 million number.
Okay, was that, and forgive the consistent line of questioning here, but is that in here anywhere? Have we covered that?
There's one big package. That's the combination of prior two meetings here that included some of the details, because one page has all the details of the assumption construction. It's page 20 of the big package over, and that was put a remember folder in it. I think it's in the second meeting on January 11th that has a breakdown of sidewalk, demolition, parking garage, everything.
The only thing that one is doing is what you do with the
correct.
Right. So, I just want to say that you're not alone. So the smaller group that met, we had the same question.
Yeah. Okay.
One of the major things we wanted to, so as we were thinking about like how to present this to a group and get it digestible in a time frame that's reasonable here, the first thing was like, we just really wanted to be sure that nobody was like, hell no, we don't need to build this, we can leave the old building be, you know, so I think that question will come, you know, I don't want to speak for you, but.
Yeah, that would be. We'll get into what our recommendation is, but the first thing is we just accept the fact we have to do something. And then the question is how do we do it in the most effective and efficient way for the county, which is sort of one of the challenges. But the first charge is do we accept that fact? And that was that first meeting with Judge Gelfman and Daryl and really talking about what we have, the problems that we have, and the potential penalties we have coming down soon. Okay?
I mean, if there's specific, if we're the page 20, I mean, if there's specific questions about that, we have to talk to you on. And I give you an example. So for the parking garage, I use a number of $24,474 for space. That would maybe on the higher end of the ranges of costs I saw. In fact, for our area, I thought was realistic. And my personal opinion was, I'd rather use something kind of towards the higher end and tell you something that's going to be lower than come in higher later. I think we had costs as low as maybe $17,000 of space from when I got from the Cottage College in the garage last year. But as a little bit larger garage, I think it might be more of a simple garage because we'll be able to fill and do more things like video surveillance, if you want to have, you know, parking fees, that kind of thing, the small upcharges that you have for those kind of things in the garage. But I can give you the ranges that I picked from. You can see kind of where my number was. I can give you an overall range for specific items.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. Any other questions or relative to that issue? Good point. So can I get, I just not a formal order of the census, is everyone okay with moving forward in terms of we have to do something? So, you know, I'm going to ask Steve Hunt to do it. What we then looked at is, we should question too, how it's going to be financed. What's the best way to do this for the county and get the best thing? If you can walk through what we should sure. Look at.
Thank you, Steve. excuse my voice as well. Second question, you know, we did this in a series of questions. The first one was, should we even do this? And we all have agreement on that. So assuming that might happen, we moved on to look at, okay, if we're going to do this, how is it we're going to do this? How are we going to finance this? And so we broke down the four options, models, that were presented to us by our IMG consultants. And they're here on this page. Just to review quickly, option one is the conventional model where the county does the financing, they manage the project, the design, the build, the bidding process, the operations maintenance, the whole nine yards, all in, it's really all on the county to do. Second model is the first hybrid where the county will finance it, but we will bring in another company to, in essence, manage the project itself. So, you know, the county would still have the financial burden, but, you know, somebody else would be doing the on-the-ground management of the project, in terms of design, build, operations, maintenance. The third one is a hybrid scenario where it's partial public, partial private. In our discussions, what the classic model of that is a 50-50, but, you know, that is negotiable. You can move that number around depending on how much burden you want the county to take, in terms of percentages. No matter what the percentage is, it would be a private entity, again, managing the project. And then the fourth model is your, what is pretty much your classic garden variety P3, where the financing is private, the management is private, and the reimbursement is through public means, with availability payments, as things are delivered. We looked at the presentation provided by IMG, the questions that came through. There were, I want to say, 7 pages worth of questions that came in from you all. As Steve mentioned, he made some phone calls or emails to various people to get their feedback. And yeah, we spent a good 2 hours just crunching these. We looked at the cost at every stage of the life cycle, you know, what the design cost, what construction cost would be. We looked at options like, you know, do we do this but don't do the parking garage? So we looked at a variety of scenarios, and a variety of costs. I think our approach was to look at the worst case scenario from a cost standpoint. I think, you know, we talked about it earlier, it's better to just say, this is what it could be if it's at its highest range, as opposed to say, well, it could be this. And we looked at the risks, because each one of these scenarios come with a risk. And so in making our recommendation, we certainly did a bit of a risk analysis while we were discussing the whole matter. So pretty much that's the bolts of it.
Any questions as to how we went through that? It's all information that you, by and large, assume. We just sort of pulled it down into what we call a work on it. If Larry and Ryan would walk us through the financial impact summary and what we, as the small group, came to sort of our recommendations to the committee.
Yeah, so a lot of detail here, and happy to dive in. The Reader's Digest version is it really comes down to 4 options, and there's certainly room for some level of spectrum here, but if you just for convenience isolate these before, we have, again, option one, that's kind of how we've done it before. We've had a lot of discussion about what that means, what the risks are, what the burden that puts on the county, et cetera. Basically, option 4, alternatively, is entirely financed independently. We sort of eliminated that only because the cost swing in borrowing is something like 300 basis points between what the county can borrow for and what the private entity can borrow for. That doesn't seem like a great idea on its face to just borrow the money at a higher rate, pay more for it. Option 2, conversely, is the county borrowing money entirely, which at some level financially obviously makes an enormous amount of sense. As we sort of dug into it, our final recommendation settled around option 3, and the basic reason for that is that is enforcement. So for some portion, whether it's half or 30% or 70%, I don't know, for someone to think about who's smarter than me, having some level of privately financed capital is important because of the hammer it brings for the county and enforcement downstream. So, frankly, the walk-away option on 2 is you lose the progress payments and the potential cost to the concession. The potential cost of the concessionaire is limited to loss of progress payments, which sort of creates a dynamic where a walk-away might be feasible, and, you know, go out of business, et cetera, et cetera. Well, if they have skin in the game in terms of financing at some level beyond that, then you are going to pay an incremental 300 basis points for that, but you're also going to carry around the risk to them that they're, you know, that they're going to default on that debt. So from our perspective, exactly what that number is, you know, we'll have some conversation about, but the 3 was important because it brought it combined the financial strength of the county with the management efficiencies of having something private, in a way that sort of gave the county all the tools it needed to be able to manage this.
And also down the road, that we weren't, we used the term kicking the can, but we knew what our costs were, we knew what our costs would be for the life cycle of the project, and wasn't that we weren't going to have any unknowns. And so what we understood, we weren't giving it to either another council or another county executive says it's your problem down the road. So that was one of the things that made recommendations really important. Low cost clearly, you know, had some. And as far as delivery date, it was one of the sooner delivery dates. The only one that was actually a couple months earlier was option two, but the risk with that it would go longer. So that didn't seem like a good move for us.
Yeah, and option one, by the way, which we call kicking the can down the road.
Right.
From both the council and the county executive, from a political risk, it's the easiest thing to do. But it's the most risk ultimately to the county. In option three, basically there is no deferred maintenance risk. And if you look at why someone invested in the concessionaire or in this financial vehicle, what they're investing in is an income stream. And the income stream is driven by their ability to design efficiencies into the building so they get their progress payments and make their margin there. So it's a win for us, but it's also in the private sector which drives the operational efficiency of the building in terms of the design efficiency.
So you can also talk about, we looked at other places where this has been done and been done successfully.
Yep.
So it wasn't like this, the option three has never been done before, but we've seen it work successfully in other places.
Steve?
When you guys were looking at it from a risk perspective, and you know, you're talking about that you have, they have some skin in the game for doing that. Obviously, the biggest risk is still to the county, because I'm assuming, I mean, I'm going through this, that what we're believing there is something happens to that entity that they can sell those rights and somebody else could take over that position so that we still wouldn't have to do it in the event that they got into some other sort of trouble.
That's good.
So let me sort of frame that. Mm-hmm. So one of the things, so as we talked about, okay, what are the worst cases in the job? Mm-hmm. The worst case in two is that you get the worst of all worlds because you borrowed money, it was wasted. The upfront sunk cost that the contractor has and the penalties they will pay add up to some level of liability. What it is the liability, if they compare that to the liability of actually performing on the contract and those things turn upside down, then you're down the line with a bad project, the contractor's walking away, it's the most expensive, you know, approach. So, the reason for to go to option three was only to rebalance that risk profile. So whether, let's see, cost-wise, there's some really good questions that we haven't talked about here in terms of what number should you pick, should it be some risk, but turning that dial to the place where you can unbalance that with a risk with them potentially walking away goes lower. That's kind of how we framed it. So
well, that's for somebody else. I mean, that's for, if this recommendation is for, that's for the council,
exactly.
The executive to decide what's that ratio, what are we willing to pay for that risk
and the
assumption.
The contracts, right?
Clearly. Because if we're saying it's 25-75, because 25 is enough, or no, we want 40 to make, you know, we're willing to pay that delta on the 3% on the difference.
And we were really deciding between 0 and 100. Mm-hmm. No, it shouldn't be 0, and no, it shouldn't be 100. It's really what we're saying.
Should be somewhere in
between. Right.
And the one thing the consultants said to us, and it was sort of stuck out in the report, that in Model 2, which is sort of like we do all the financing, but it's a project. And that's where I think the county initially started. That was the administration.
Somebody else managed it, but we'll fund it.
Yeah, was because you looked at pure cost and not anything else. See, Model 2 is likely to be more conventional in nature, but with a much longer duration than normal conventional contracts. Model 2 could, if not structured well, lead to the worst of both worlds, a long-term contract with a single partner without an effective risk transfer and performance mechanism in the O&M side, and deferred maintenance. Because you're getting a low-cost bill in the front end, they're not going to care. That's the process within the income stream, downwards. And therefore, Model 2, most likely. Now, when I talked with Josh, and I think we discussed this in our session, is, you know, we brought in a consultant. This is not something we've done. This is not the sign of thing you want to do in your first one. So we brought a consultant, and I think IMG's done a good job of bringing us up to speed and giving us the pieces. But the next piece, and we asked this question of Holly when we met, because we said, you need to have this cost in there. I'm told it is in there. You need counsel. The devil is in the document, in the contract. And so we have a consultant, that's one part, but you need counsel that is done public-private partnerships with municipalities and has a lot of experience. And they've worked with our Office of Law in the county. And that's already built into the cake, is what I want
to do. Only what I was trying to make for the way I was looking at the whole group is that, what we're saying is we're willing to pay a little bit more for that transfer as opposed to doing ourselves. Now, when you go through some of the information here, you know, this is going to trip us up over the 10%. One of the three measurements that we have, it would do it regardless.
Right.
I mean, that's assuming all else be equal, we're going to continue to do school construction and everything else. We were going to trip anyway if we decided to move forward with this.
Yes.
And we're comfortable with that.
Yeah. And, one of the other things we talked about, and I think you know, Larry or Steve said, but we did talk about that garage. He said, is there another way? Is it a revenue bond? Mm-hmm. And we do that. Said it's obviously saying, geez, I go down to Inner Harbor, East Harbor, and you go down to Little Italy, and they have a garage there, it's only $4. So they basically are not looking to make profit, they're looking to cover their financing costs. So there's some reasonable ways to look at that piece that might be helpful. We talked initially, what if you just don't do a garage, but we also listened to the access issue and the distance, and we thought that was not, you know, so what we try to do is not be short-sighted. One part was that, okay, what if you did just a minimal in design and let somebody else, which is kicking the can, worry about when the next expansion takes place versus doing it the right way. And the real cost, the other thing is in the O&M, the cost of deferred maintenance is can be cataclysmic, very large when you don't do it. And so we're building into this, because of the size of the project, we're building it in on the front end, which is de-risking the county. And it's really de-risking, it's not this council, it's not this executive. What we're doing is trying to make a good business decision for the county long-term, for future councils and future executives that are kicking it down. That's sort of the opportunity, but I wanted to say to the group, if we're looking for certainty of what the final cost is, or that there won't be a cost overrun, or not a cost overrun, it's not in our purview. It's not realistic to be looking at it in terms of how we make the decision, because those things are out of our, with the information we have, we're being asked to make a recommendation. And I went back to the council because I wanted to make sure in this political world that we live, that everyone was on board. And that's because I said, we're spending a lot of time, a lot of effort. And I talked to John, who's the council chairman. He clearly told me that they were going to look, that they really, as much as they were looking at our opinion, because we looked at it as much as independent people taking a look at the information coming at it from that direction. So that's sort of where we are. Just open it up for other questions or comments.
Actually, Steve, to your point and also yours, Alex, about the real cost, you know, risk management was a big thing for us. And if you look at options 3 and 4, they really are the ones that do the best job of mitigating risk, because the concessionaire is incentivized to keep those cost overruns from happening. They're getting paid to make sure that they deliver at a certain value, at a certain time to make availability for us. Whereas with the first two options, which was public financing, yeah, it's wide open. So if you're looking at it from a risk perspective, those are really a better approach. Yes, you're going to spend, you put a little more money out, to your point, Steve, but you also have more opportunity to drive the cost down so that the ultimate price tag is lower than it would be under the conventional model.
Well, you get out there in the point that you have, at the end of this period of time, a building that is usable at that period of time with no necessary deferred maintenance in 30 years. You go beyond that, even though we're not putting that into the model and talking about it, you're not having to replace this building in 30 years.
Correct.
To me, that's the point also, one of the factors. We're sitting here in 2017, and we're doing business in the courthouse. It was built in the late 1880s. So when you factor it, by the time we get to the end of this financing tier, 30 years, we're just getting comfortable based on our practice.
You don't have to come in from that. I can tell you what my plot is.
One of the ways I've settled in thinking about it is if we go with a hybrid model, all we're really doing is deciding to pay an incremental cost of money or
some amount of leverage, and that fundamental calculus is, I think, what maybe that's what I leave it with. Anything that's not the pool of county has.
I like how you put that as opposed to, you know, a lot of my struggle on all this is that risk transfer, because I still see us holding all the risk, because regardless of what they finance, we're still there. We still need that courthouse. We still need to operate. Even if they go away, we're going to have to take care of whatever debt that they have. We're going to have to do all those different things. But at least we'll have those triggers and the ability to hold it against somebody to make sure they're continuing to do the things they need to do before you get to that point.
Whatever questions or comments, and what we also tried to, hopefully you get some feedback, we tried to, we probably need a couple more graphics to go to the council and the county executive, but we try to do this in a way that's all this behind it and walk through the process, but to try to make it easy.
Is this what you're here for, that?
That's right.
85,
95. How bad is this? Debt service percentage get if we don't get the economic growth numbers of 3.5%. How high does it get if we in 2023 if you get 2% growth or 2.5 or something? Is there any significant delta? Does that kick us to less than AAA? And if so, is it really a big deal? Except mentally.
I'll defer to Hyde. I in the short run, I don't think so. One of the things, again, a conversation I had with John Weinstein with the delegation has put forth legislation to take the Ag Preservation Fund downstream community restoring remediation, something we recommended, okay, and it was a good idea. And I asked John, I talked to him, I said, our concern is exactly what you're talking about, is the operating fund, making sure because that's the funds that deal with people's needs. And so we're reaching that, and what we'd like to discuss have you consider is how we can use it to reduce that debt quickly and get underneath it. Maybe look at that money differently. And I also, and when we get to the spending affordability in our formal things, I think we have to be stronger and more, I know there's suggestions, but stronger relative to getting enabling legislation that says all those transfer taxes need to be on at least a 4-year basis. Reviewed, whether it's by this committee or an independent committee, reviewed in terms of the revenue coming in and where it's being used and is it the best use for the county. I think that, you know, we need to do that, and we've talked about it for 2 years. I think we've got to put more teeth on it. The fact that John has done this and is open to looking at it differently is, I think, very helpful, because ultimately, when we come back to our day job, we want to put, really want to create more money in the operating fund as a ratio so that we can spend more money on people's needs, social and other. And so I'm with you, and the fact that it reaches over 10 hits me in the gut, because that's what we've been pushing the other way. And I even questioned, because Holly talked about whether there's going to be $95 million in spending the next couple of years. And I called her on that, because I said, well, we only not that we have any say, we recommended 85. He said, well, the 90 is really the stand, because we spent time saying, well, we got to get into all this authorized but unused bonds, and it's really some of the rundown of those. And we'll, when we get into our full committee and spending affordability, we're going to see some, get some more data on what's happened since last year.
Most of that other, I mean, the one where I look at it is most of the other spending that we're doing is by choice. This, to me, when I looked at the courthouse, this isn't a choice. We have to do this, because if we don't do this, we're going to start to, you know, get penalized. And we don't do anything with those dollars. They just go away. We can't. There's no investment. We're just transferring money. And we have to do this. Other decisions we made are quality of life, schools, whatever else it is, and we'll have to, as a county, make those decisions so that that 10% comes back down. So we have to slow school construction, or we have to slow other things, so that we don't risk our financial health. That's what those are the decisions that, you know, the executive and the council have to make. This is not a choice.
It's just a
otherwise we're just throwing money away.
Right. It's just a what's the best methodology?
Yeah.
And the question of the bond rating, that's a really good one. That, and I'm recalling from last year in the great conversation we had, remember there were
I'm not sure of the details here, but there are four measures basically that Moody looked at. The one that we've tracked is the 10 basis points, but the one I guess that they care most about, as I understand it, is some of the other, like the potential ratio of like incomes. I don't, you probably know better than me, but we're not that close on the ones where Moody's really going to blow us up, is what I recall.
Yeah, because they see our ability.
And
tax. Yes.
And plus, it goes to 10 in 5 to 7 years. We're at the end of the business cycle. It's probably, I mean, I haven't finished my forecast for the county yet. We're going to have a downturn at this point, so it's likely to hit 10 under any scenario. Yeah, where I'm a little.
I wasn't prepared for the, you know.
The likely to hit 10 even if we don't do the courthouse?
Yeah, I mean, it's likely to come close regardless. We're going to have a recession in the next 5 to 7 years. I'm not saying we're going to have one in the next year or two, but we're 7, 8 years into a business cycle. They usually hit 7 years into the business cycle. So I would not worry so much about long term forecasts. If you have to do it, we don't have a choice of not building the courthouse.
Wasn't that when some of the agriculture money was going to be tipping the right way?
Yeah, I think it's 25.
Well, 20 it starts, I think, and it really takes off.
We kept looking at it. We didn't want to make a recommendation to absolutely doing it until we saw it in, you know, in the black.
Right.
Okay, that was our perspective on that. And I think it still is. I think the fact that the council is taking a step on that with the delegation, that's what's got to come. It's a delegation of it. It's a positive step, and it allows us to perhaps make a recommendation on the council and talk about long-term, non-politically, what we need to be doing for fiscal management, and really giving the county the ability to, on a structured basis, to be probably
reviewing
the changes.
Now, when you show the one chart that has going above 10%, what did you take into account a possible downturn, or was that just based on?
That one was based on assumption of 3.5% increase each year. Mm-hmm. To answer the question earlier, there's a couple of things. One, if I make a guess, 3.5% average for the next 5 years, it's on the low end.
That's
what I'm saying. Because I'm relatively conservative. I know if Dr. Clinch do it, he's going to make it higher. On that there. So, but I keep it at 3.5 to give us the cushion and the flexibility and to deal with potential worst scenario. I don't know which year it might have some maybe lower than that, but on average, if you look at the 5 year and the as a range, I would think that I'll be really surprised if we as 3.5%. But that's one thing. The second thing is general fund of base plus other fund, fire, tax, etc. It's $1.7 billion total when we develop or calculate this ratio there. So that with that big raise base, it increased by 2% versus 3.5% for a single year. When you do the calculation, it's not going to change too much originally. 10%, it might still be 10.0 point something. It's really going to be marginal impact. It's not going to impact a lot. And thirdly, I think people already mentioned that the county has proved and will continue to be very fiscally prudent in home management, financial management. And that's actually one of the reasons the bond rating agencies view us very favorably, because when they do the bond rating, it's based on a lot of different aspects on that. That income is really a portion of a lot of other parameters here. And as you can see, the past 2 years is evidence. 1 year, we have a mid-year shortfall on revenue. We didn't do any layoff, we didn't restack, et cetera. We were able to manage that. When we closed that year, we actually added a little bit of surplus because we managed to do that without hurting the people, without doing things through COVID. And then we have our casino funding. Again, we were able to use prior year surplus through savings and better than anticipated revenues to deal with without digging into rainy day fund, without running on services. So we're going to maintain that management in a very unlikely situation that disaster hit and make the fiscal condition worse than what we anticipated in general. we're meant to do it. We're going to make sure we don't hurt our financial base. We don't sacrifice our long-term system.
Is there any other massive building on the short horizon that would be of this kind of magnitude or similar to this?
In the current multi-year CIP, we're going to manage to make sure that's in the target range there without making over that, at least in this like 6 year period of time there.
This is a new high school. With that, I think we talked about that less, and they tend to phase in those.
Yeah, they don't get spread over the years, and it's not covered.
And that's about the same cost as.
And the Moody's process is for, they don't take you from AAA to AA overnight. They give you a period to adjust.
Well,
AA
is not necessarily.
And AA is
terrible. Small pieces.
So I wouldn't worry that much about this.
I would add two things. One is, as Holly has said, when the rating agencies look at the county, one of the things they look at is this committee and the process that we go through. Because they look at that as real management versus when we walked in about 3 years ago, when the county drove this itself, if I was rating agency, I'd look at it a little differently than where it's been independent. And it's been, you know, with certainly tremendous support from the county, but it's independently run. So I think that goes, they probably have all of your email addresses and pictures. I think we're in good shape. And the other thing that they, and I remember from 20 years ago looking at this, the thing that they also look at is our, if you look at the per capita debt and the ability to tax, they look at the government's ability if they have to raise, dirty word, in politics, but to raise taxes if you had to. So they look at that capacity when they're also looking at that ratio. I think from our standpoint, we're running a county and running a business. Okay, so we look at that, I think we should look at it with a higher discipline on that ratio. Because we're really looking at what does the county do and where do we need the money where it can reach our citizens what we need and give the county the best place to live.
Steve, all good points and Richard and Holly and Brian. You guys are correct in that while the four measures that Moody's are looking at are important, it's the overall picture that they're looking at. And they'll look at this project and see that it's a one-time bump, if you will. But they would equally look at the fact that we didn't do this project, that we have unmet needs that have to be addressed in the future. And the questions would come to us, how are you going to handle this? So it's not a damned if you do, a damned if you don't. They're looking at how we manage this committee, the stability of management in the county, the overall wealth of the county, but the fact that we have organized processes. Yes, they will question this project, but I would equally tell you they would question if we were not doing this project. How are you going to handle this expense?
Other comments, or questions? If I can, then I'd like to get a vote. The recommendation is that we recommend to the county executive and to the council that we do this project and that we use a public-private partnership. And our recommendation, which I think, of course, changed, is that we use Model 3. It may deviate from that somewhat, but Model 3, where there's a 50-50 risk transfer or risk split between them. And actually, it's more than. We're transferring all the O&M risk and all the deferred maintenance risk. That's, we're leveraging that through the 50% transfer of finance.
Steve, do we feel confident enough to say 50-50?
I think so. I mean, we felt confident say $85 million. They're going to ultimately make a business in the county, between the county executive and the council. If they want to change that, that's up to them. But I think 50-50. I feel comfortable with that. I guess in going through all the discussion, I feel comfortable that because it's what I really want to do is put enough risk in the concessionaire that they need those progress payments to make the deal work. And I think that 50% is a good use of our financial ability, but also a good risk transfer and leverage. And it'll start regular design phase. force the design phase to be working more long-term in that project in terms of terms of flows.
And again, to back our recommendation, if you look at, you know, we have the recommendation page, which is for option three. You know, Steve, there's a backup page. I don't know if you want to go through this. Is, you know, in our follow analysis, why not the other options? So it kind of takes you through the risks associated with each and why this is, all things considered, the one that does the best job of this management. So, anyway.
The other reason, by the way, we look at people were because you there's something to look at that makes us sound. There was no way that we felt comfortable in the environment recommending that we do 100% private financing. We just thought that would be a no-starter and that would create more issues that would get in the way of doing what's right than what we recommend. Even though I made the case that, and again, I encourage you, at the University of Kentucky, they basically take the whole campus for education really trust that we, and they are basically, and it's for a different set of reasons, a different set of capital needs, but they're having them redo their whole campus and all the dorms, and it's been a great success. And not the same as this, but a great success, but they've gotten the professional management, they've actually, the metrics have increased retention, the grades have gone up because they have a better place to study and live. So there's some really, really good things, but like anything else, in a project, you know, it's managing the project, it's going through the bid process, getting the right.
And totally for the
right project. That's fine. I think there's some guarantees behind that.
Yeah, but it's not.
And that would be because, going to the University of Maryland, they don't have that access to cash. They just do that. They have to use their statements. It's an alternative way to expedite and make faster things that you need done. Different reason.
Well, the other thing with Kentucky is, as far as doing 100% private financing, it is a revenue, the buildings are revenue generating, as you think about the fact, you know, tuition, et cetera, et cetera. So that, under that scenario, you know, 100% private is a little bit of a better way to go because you're going to get that revenue.
And when we come back, because we'll have a written recommendation, we're asking for yours, a vote, but we'll actually come back next week with a written recommendation. And one of the things I think we include within that is at least the statement that we think that the garage needs to be looked at as a potentially from a revenue bond and the fees associated with it. It's most office buildings everywhere I go and throughout the country and throughout the local, there's a fee. It doesn't have to be not downtown Baltimore, New York, it's an exorbitant fee. Cost. And I would add, the college where you serve them, where they recover their costs, that's with their student fee. They increase their student fee by X dollars to cover the cost of the garage. That's how they do it. So it would be just a way to do that by the users.
Okay. But that's not part of what we're saying. We're just saying, the only thing we're talking about today is
we're doing this
free, and that's it. No revenue.
No. I would say when we do the recommendation, we're going to it's appropriate to consider that when you look at it as one way to further de-risk financially.
In option four, I had to leave early last week because I didn't have a question. They assume lower construction costs of unit A data taken.
It's higher financing costs.
If you use private sector financing, you don't have to use any wages. You don't have to pay any construction.
Well, we're not.
I didn't really take that into account because I was thinking about a junior life cost.
Your costs are consistent with your experience with GSA, and that would assume Davis Bacon.
That would assume Davis Bacon. Yes, that would assume Davis Bacon. Yes. So the reason you do pure play private, I looked at this for the county 5 or 6 years ago, but only option one versus option two. The reason you want to do a pure play private partnership is you don't pay Davis Bacon, so your construction costs are
if you listen to some people, 5% is, and some people, 20% is below.
Hey, Steve. The IMG, they're here, right? Mm-hmm. The IMG guys?
They're here. Yes, they're
here. In your experience, has that become an issue or come up, and how's that, has that been a fact of the private financing when you work with government entities eliminate that requirement, which helps the cost?
It doesn't happen.
No.
You still have to
do it. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. In our experience, so in the project we worked on, it was the same. I'm sorry? Yeah. In the projects we worked on, the Davis Bacon was just as applicable. So it was just basically a pass through. So that's also what we assumed under for this project. So under all the models, we're using the same exact base construction cost.
I know we're not picking vendors exactly, but Medco is an option, and if using them as an agent, they don't pay sales tax on any of the construction materials. So there's a potential savings there as a mechanism to as your private partner.
But back to the question that Richard was asking. So, if they're assuming Davis Bacon in all four scenarios, and it doesn't happen, that would be a savings.
Potential.
Jim, there's not the Davis Bacon requirement in the county unless you have federal funds. So we historically do not have contractors with unions. Subcontractors bid on jobs. It's just a low bid. There's no requirement for Davis Bacon.
So county schools don't pay Davis Bacon? Well, because there is federal money there.
Sometimes they pay on where the money comes from, but the local government do not.
So when you build something else, you don't pay Davis Bacon?
Only when you get a grant.
Okay.
Always good to have information.
So it really is an apples to apples comparison.
It is apples to apples,
yeah.
Right.
Because it doesn't matter.
Right.
Okay, so if I can, this will be it's an informal formal vote because we need to get the actual written report, written recommendation next week to be but if I can get a sense of the motion would be that the committee recommends that the county executive and council that we build a courthouse, that we use private-public partnership, and that Model 3 be the model that is most efficient and effective for the county.
Can
I get any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. So we will move to put a written report together that we will bring next week, the meeting, and then meet with the county council on the 28th. February, that was 14 or something like that.
No,
that's Coach K's birthday. He's 7th, 6 weeks ahead.
Twenty-third.
There's
two meetings.
I had it down
to
13.
Yeah, it's the 13th.
Yeah,
one of
the
13th.
The 13th.
Yeah.
And originally, of course, I think it's the
meeting point is after the last meeting, I pushed back and said we're not going to do something until we're ready.
So should we just meet on the 25th, right?
I think that's possible. You know, 20.
So no meeting on that.
Because we'll try to get the same, not make any surprises, and then get here, so we take that pass and move into it.
Let's go to 16th. Oh, we'll go to 23rd.
So we're not going to meet.
We're meeting Monday.
We're not meeting on
Monday. We're not meeting.
Because you've been so good.
Kill the 23rd. 16th was the past Monday.
Oh, sorry, you're right.
Yeah, which we did be
there. So, for two things. One, and look at how efficient we've been. One, I want to thank Larry, Ryan, and Steve for spending some time, and Holly for opening this office building and working with us. And a lot of work that went in, so she had information questions that we had so we could look at. Secondly, I want to thank our consultants, ING. You've done a terrific job getting us up to speed to be able to look at this. It's not something most of us think about daily. And what we're trying to do is what's best for the county, and you gave us a good, I think, leg up in terms of some background information, and the information allowed us to make the changes and is the right decision. So thank you for working with us, and we underestimate, I know because when I call Holly, trying to get her in with the information, how much time was spent by the consultants and by the county staff in pulling this all together. It's not 9 to 5. It's how we work. And so I want to thank all of you for what you've done. And we'll move on. And as we move on to the spending affordability, there are not borrowing issues, there are spending issues. We want to look at a report of exactly where we are and the other suggestions we made last year, a status report on that. So we have that. And then I want us to, again, as I said, I want us to sort of couple with this to look really in a much stronger way at the transfer tax relative to how that's evaluated and get some structure around that rather than just leaving it, rather than us kicking it down the road. Because I think that's, we sort of just said people do it, but it's like when I deal with my boss and I tell him, here's what I really think. Recognizing they have lots of priorities. So they don't get to everything that I happen to think is important, and I understand that. But this one I think is important for me to get into the, and in fact, the council is also, the chair is looking at this, allows us, I think, to do it in a decent way. Any other? Okay, we're in class. This is pretty amazing.
Yeah,
825. Thank you.
Very good.